Thank you so much, sir. Thank you so much for this kind introduction. Hi, Rukia. Hi, Ashna. Many regards to Dr. N.K. Singh as well. At the outset, let me thank for the opportunity given to me to present this elegant trial, great study, which is a pragmatic study. I think I am first of all thankful to Dr. Banshee Sabu, sir, and I would definitely take this opportunity to congratulate him for his biggest venture ever, Defeat Diabetes. He has done a miracle. I feel he has united everybody. And I don't know how many pre-diabetics we have diagnosed and how many diabetics we have made them realize that you need to control your sugar. It's the biggest, I think, preventive movement in the sector of healthcare. I would say after pulse polio or HIV movement, probably it's a 100-day mission, which has really inspired all of us. And I would again like to congratulate, sir, for yesterday's inauguration ceremony, which was almost, like initiation of Satyagraha ceremony. I mean, and so many of top KOLs from India attended with 100% attendance till the end of the program. So I'm very fortunate enough, I was fortunate enough to attend that program yesterday. Now, going into the, 1 second, so I'm little technologically challenged. Yeah, there it is. Neelam, somehow I'm not able to do it.
Sharing option is there.
Ma'am, we can share your slides.
Can you? Yeah, because there are very few slides. So if you can share, then it will be faster. Yeah. So this is a pragmatic study, very, very elegant study. I think after the legendary study, UKPDS, that happened 25 years back, it was initiated 25 years back. After that, there were no studies which were comparing glycemic efficacy of glucose-lowering therapy and their effect on patient-related outcome and how to individualize therapy. See, ADA nowadays has completely patient-centric approach. So whenever we are treating our patients with type 2 diabetes, we must have an individualized approach. And for that approach, we need head-to-head comparison studies. And till today, till great study results were out last year in ADA, this ADA in June, there were no head-to-head studies. Now, next slide, Neelam. There has to be some necessity for invention. For any great invention, there has to be first necessity. So what was the necessity for this study? That in USA in 2011, they realized that there was a threefold increase in diabetes in 2011. From 1985 to 2011, there was a dramatic increase in prevalence of diabetes. Next slide. There were about more than 24 million diabetic patients in 2011, and the incidence was 1.6 million new cases per year. And within the period of 1995 to 2010, there were so many drugs which were added to the armamentarium of glucose-lowering therapies. 8 new classes of drugs were added. There was no precision about initiation of the drug and what can be the durability of the effects, side effects, and what are the indications and contraindications. So these were the few points which were basically forcing US authorities, health authorities, to go into some study which will have some head-to-head comparison of glucose-lowering therapies to basically fight with not only diabetes, but the complications of diabetes as well. Next slide. So this was the background, and till that time, the protocol was whenever first validated therapy was patient comes to you, give trial of lifestyle and metformin, then go on adding to either basal insulin or sulfonylurea. This is absolute patient-centric approach. It was patient's choice whether SU should be added or basal insulin. If there is treatment failure, then you intensify insulin therapy, or there was a less validated approach, like rather than adding insulin or sulfonylurea, you add one more insulin sensitizer, which is pioglitazone, or you can add one more injectable therapy, that is GLP-1 agonist. And then you intensify therapy, still A1C not controlled, then you can intensify insulin therapy by adding short-acting insulin to your basal insulin. This was a routine protocol which everybody was following for each and every patient with type 2 diabetes. Next slide. So almost there was no head-to-head comparison to guide choice of which medication should be added to metformin. There were 8 drugs available, but which should be added to which patient, there was no this thing. And so many pharmaceutical industries, but nobody had incentive to provide finances for such head-to-head studies because everybody was scared, what if my drug fails? And there was very little data to guide individualization therapy, which is called precision medicine or personalized medicine. Next slide. So GRADE was basically designed to help guide the choice of glucose-lowering medication. First of all, why do we treat diabetes? Because it has to be a glucose-centric approach. We need to lower HbA1c. Then the durability, that is very important. Though drug is effective, it should be a durable, because diabetes being a lifelong problem or chronic nature, you have to have a therapy which will last for many years. Then what is the effect on complication? Is it going to aggravate complications, or for that matter, is it going to have some preventive effect on complications? What is going to be the tolerability and adverse effect? Study results would facilitate individualization of therapy on this basis, and obviously the health cost. See, now in USA, UK, they have everywhere insurance system. So they definitely need to look into the cost factor as well. So they have to address cost benefit when they are individualizing the therapy for each and every patient. Nobody should be overtreated, or nobody should be given a drug which is actually not required for him. But patients, the therapy cost goes down because government has to pay for it. So they needed to address the cost benefit ratio as well. So these were few rationales before starting great study. Next slide. Neelam, can we go to the next slide? Yeah, thank you. Now, what is the treatment goal? Glycemic goals in adults is first lowering of HbA1c either at 7% or below 7%, so that you reduce microvascular complications, neuropathy complications in type 1, type 2 diabetic. And obviously, this is for non-pregnant adults, because for pregnant adults, we require A1c less than 6.5%. Next slide. Now, whenever any study is designed, first we decide about the outcomes. Now, what was the primary outcome? Comparison of relative effects of 4 commonly used medicines. Which medicines? We will go into it in the next slide. That with different mechanisms of action, first was time to reach HbA1c at more than 7%. So, when a drug is initiated, it is given in the maximum dose. Suppose, for example, glimepiride is added to metformin, the maximum dose of glimepiride is reached. See, now patient's HbA1c has started going above 7%. That is primary metabolic outcome. That means there is a need to add one more drug. So what is secondary metabolic outcome? Secondary metabolic outcome is time to go above 7.5%. When a drug is not able to keep A1c below 7.5%, at that time you need to intensify treatment. So if suppose patient is non-insulin treated, you need to add a basal insulin, and you need to intensify insulin therapy. What is tertiary metabolic outcome? If A1C is still 7.5 after some days of therapy from secondary metabolic study, then there is a need that you have to stop the assigned medication. Metformin definitely remains in the background, but you stop assigned medicine and then you intensify insulin therapy by adding aspart, that was which was added in that therapy. Then you add short-acting medicine to intensify insulin therapy, and you see to it that A1C comes below 7%. These were the metabolic outcome guidelines given when study was started. Next slide. Now, cumulative incidence of diabetic complications, such as first is microalbuminuria, 30 cutoff was taken. Then metabolic outcomes for macrovascular problems, CVD risk factors, quality of life, tolerability, cost effectiveness. These were the parameters considered as secondary outcomes of that study. Determine the phenotypic characteristics is very important. We are not treating type 2 diabetic patients with one particular group of racialcity or ethnicity. We need to know what is phenotypic response for these different 4 medications over the time. Next slide. So these are the 4 glucose lowering therapy which were selected. That first patient has to be only on metformin therapy, and it has to be drug naive for other drugs except metformin. Minimum of 1000 to maximum 2000 milligram of metformin should be on the background. Then classes of drug which was selected, sulfonylurea glimepiride, which was approved. See, drugs had to be US FDA approved. So in 99, glimepiride was approved, 2006, sitagliptin, 2010, liraglutide, and 2000, glargine was approved. So these were the four standard drugs which were approved by US FDA for, these were the four glucose lowering medications which were selected for this study. All drugs were prescribed and adjusted according to their labeling. Definitely glargine and glimepiride being stronger glucose lowering agent. SMBG, frequent SMBG was taught to the patients, aiming for fasting glucose level between 80 to 130 and avoidance of hypoglycemia. Next slide. The modification, this is the biggest drawback, I would say, because when the study started in 2013, in 2012, the study was designed, and that was the time when SGLT2 CANA was available in USA, and SGLT2 and inhibitors wasn't approved in USA until GRACE study was planned or funded or initiated. So this was the medication right now, which is the, Shah Rukh Khan of diabetology medicine, which was not added. So that was the only drawback, I would say, that great when it ended and produced the results, SGLT2 was not, added in that study. That would be one of the drawback, I would say. Next slide. Now, how it happened? Very simple. They took patients who were between the age of 30 to 65, around 30 to 70 years of age. A1C should be more than 6.8 at screening, and duration of the diabetes should be less than 5 to 10 years. Patients should be only on the background of metformin therapy. They should not be already, given any glimepiride or any of those four medicines or any other OHA as well. Patients should be exposed only to metformin. Now, patients who were having HbA1c between 6.8 and 8.5, they were, initiated, final run-in visits were done, and they were randomized equally. 5,000 patients, 37 centers from USA were collected, and they were randomized. This was an unmasked trial because oral as well as injectable therapy, both the therapies were used. So it could not be a blinded trial. It was an unmasked trial. Sulfonylurea, glimepiride was initiated. DPP-4 sitagliptin was initiated, GLP-1 liraglutide, and insulin glargine was initiated in the dose of 10 units per day, bedtime. Next slide. Now, in 2008, there was an initial proposal. In 2009, planning meets started with ADA support group. In 2010, there was initial planning funded by NIDDK. Then 2012, first research group meeting happened. In 2012, October, clinic funding initiated. And mind you, this was non-pharma sponsored trial. There was no pharma sponsor. The sponsorship was only by NIDDK, which was in government health organization. 2013, they started initial screening. June 2013, first randomization happened, and recruitment almost continued for 3 to 4 years till 2017. 2017, April, they stopped recruitment, and by May 2021, the end of data collection started, and we need to know this, that May 2021, we started data collection. This was pandemic time, COVID time. Still, in spite of these adverse conditions, the collection of data was very much transparent, and retention period or retention of patients was almost more than 90%. Maybe on telemedicine platform, but patients' retention was very, very good. And June 21, ADA, the report preliminary main results were out. Now let's see what are the results in next slides. Next slide, Neela. So these were 37 centers. All the centers were definitely from United States. I think 150 patients from each center were collected, giving numbers to 5,000 individuals with type 2 diabetes. Next slide. Baseline characteristics, if we see around age-wise, if we see 46% patients were between 45 to 59, more than 60 was 40% of patients, and very few number of patients, 12% of patients were between the age of 30 to 45. And women were around 36% and male number were about 63%. Next slide. Racial differences, majority of the population, 65% of the population was white, 19% black, and rest of the very small percentage, but they tried to include Asian, American and Indian, Pacific Islander, and different Asian people. They tried to include a small population of people with other from the other races as well. Next slide. Out of 5,047 patients, 94% of the patients, in spite of COVID pandemic, could retain till the study end of the study. The duration of the follow-up was 5 years, and no significant difference among the retention among any treatment group was found. So insulin-treated patient, liraglutide patient, glimepiride patient, everybody had same rate of retention, around 90 to 95%. Next slide. Adherence was found similar. The patients followed up on the scheduled visits, and there was no difference among any treatment groups. All four groups had similar, if you see, all the four lines are meeting. So everybody had similar kind of adherence, and adherence was 90%, which is very good considering pandemic situation and the large number of subjects in the study. 90% adherence is excellent. Next slide. Let's see what is the primary, what did we find in primary metabolic outcome. When we look at the primary metabolic outcome after entering study, percentage of the patients who developed HbA1c more than 7% after some considerable duration on the treatment period, the first one to go into more than 7% failure, that 7% HbA1c, that I would call as not failure, but patient that molecule was not able to retain HbA1c below 7% was sitagliptin. Followed by that, the second molecule was glimepiride, and liraglutide and glargine almost had better percentage of keeping HbA1c around 7%. Going to the next slide, HbA1c levels immediately in all the three groups dropped down by 1%, 1.5%, and then they started rising after around 4 weeks of study, 4 to 5 weeks of studies. Next slide. HbA1c levels over first 4 years, if we see, this is what we just mentioned, that sitagliptin and glimepiride were not able to maintain HbA1c, and they went into more than 7% group immediately, and liraglutide and glargine somehow could remain below HbA1c for very long time. Next slide. Now, what was the mean time for primary outcome? Sitagliptin within 2 years could not maintain HbA1c below 7 years, sitagliptin group. So second, the basal insulin had to be added to that group earlier. Glimepiride, 2.2 years. Glargine could sustain for 2.4 years. And liraglutide also resonated with glargine. So eventually, liraglutide and glargine had the longest time until reaching primary metabolic outcome, which proves the efficacy, and by which is followed by glimepiride and then sitagliptin, maybe because of its weaker action on, it is a weaker I would say hypoglycemic agent, so it had to be intensified with insulin therapy for the second line of rate study. Next slide. Now, secondary metabolic outcome. Now, these patients who were initiated on basal insulin. Now, what is the percentage of patients who could not remain below 7.5 in each group? Again, sitagliptin patient, 55% of the patients could not retain HbA1c below 7.4. And in this group, comparing glimepiride and sitagliptin failed earlier, and glargine and liraglutide could maintain HbA1c for a longer time, but in first group, in primary metabolic outcome, glargine and liraglutide were at par, but in this group, glargine and liraglutide, when we compared, glargine did better. So in secondary metabolic outcome, glargine fared better than liraglutide. Next slide. this is something which we just explained for the primary outcome. Sitagliptin had to be initiated on insulin within 3 years, less than 3 years. Glimepiride peer group of patients had to be initiated on insulin after 3.1 years, liraglutide 3.2 years, and glargine intensification was addition of aspart, short acting insulin, after 3.5 years. Next slide. So glargine had the longest time controlling HbA1c, less than 7.5%. Now looking at microvascular outcomes, almost all the groups, percentage of participant who developed albumin to creatinine ratio above 30 was around 12 to 11%. So there was no difference between, you know, of effect on microvascular outcomes. Next slide. Neuropathy, again, the results were same. Around 69 to 72% patients developed neuropathy, and there was no statistical significant difference between all the four groups. Everybody had same kind of picture. Next slide. So in microvascular summary, in this population with relatively new onset diabetes, these were the patients who were recently diagnosed within 5 to 10 years of diabetes. There were no differences among any treatment group with respect to microalbuminuria, with respect to reduction in eGFR or incidence of distal sensory neuropathy. Next slide. Macrovascular outcome definitely had something for us. The hospitalization for heart failure, unstable angina, MACE, TIA, and revascularization, these were the events which were considered as, you know, secondary metabolic outcome studies. In that, liraglutide resonated with all the CVOTs conducted for GLP-1. And there was significant reduction in CVD incident only in liraglutide group. And then largely 7.6 faring well, and glargine, glimepiride, and sitagliptin were on the same platform, but significant reduction in CVD event was found with liraglutide, which resonated with all the CVOD trials. Next slide. Now, talking about serious adverse event, I would say weight gain event was more in glimepiride and insulin group. And nausea and flatulence, these were the events found with DPP-4 inhibitors and GLP-1. These were few minor changes. And otherwise adverse event profile was almost same in all the groups. Next slide. Pancreatitis and pancreatic cancer risk was almost nil with not significant p-value. Next slide. So the previous slide, Neelam, sorry. In summary, primary metabolic outcome, almost 50% of the patients reached primary metabolic outcome just within 3 years. Imagine patients were getting attentive diabetes care and free of charge glucose lowering therapy. The whole treatment and the medications were free. And in a country like United States, patients went into drug failure within 3 years. So probably patient education and patient adherence also plays a role, very, very important role, even if you are giving optimum glucose lowering therapy. Now, primary metabolic outcome occurred very less frequently with glargine and liraglutide. We just got convinced with the study. Sitagliptin treated patients reached primary outcome 113 days before glimepiride, 164 and 185 days before glargine and liraglutide respectively. Next slide. And there were significant differences in the response to therapies by HbA1c level, but no significant heterogeneity was found. That is very important. So eventually, glargine and liraglutide were relatively definitely more effective than glimepiride, and all three were more effective than sitagliptin, with the relative benefits increasing as the HbA1c increased. So these were the basically summary outcomes. At the end, I would like to just summarize that this is the the first head-to-head study of glucose-lowering therapies after UKPDS. Definitely, UKPDS had comparison of OHAs available at that point of time, but it had some kind of limitations that SGLT2 was not added because of lack of FDA approval, and pioglitazone and alpha-glucosidase inhibitors, these drugs were not added because of their, some potential side effects like volume retention or GI side effects. So those were the two drugs which were not added. So only four drugs were compared. But all in all, this is the study which gave us the broader perspective about individualization of the therapy, HbA1c lowering, its effect on metabolic and microvascular parameters. With that, I would like to close my session, and I'm open for any questions. Thank you so much.